Hello, welcome to the first lecture in Module 5 in Quantum Mechanics. Today we're going to be talking about Pauli spin matrices and relating operators to matrices. So in quantum mechanics, we have operators, and we often represent the operators as matrices. And I want you to remember that in the condition for spin, but also in general, operators are actually the most important objects. The matrices are just the representations of those operators. So we could actually call a theory of quantum mechanics actually a theory of operator mechanics. And the matrices are just a specific way of representing those operators in a particular basis. Nevertheless, they are often very useful in calculations. So it's important to remember that the operators are the fundamental objects in quantum mechanics, and the matrices are just the representations. This is something you already know from classical mechanics, where the vector is just an object, and that's the fundamental object, and the way that we represent it in a particular coordinate system is just a choice of a basis to represent the vector. And you should be thinking the same way, except in quantum mechanics, instead of just vectors, we also have operators and matrices. So let's talk now about spin. For spin, we have two independent states, and so the quantum mechanical vectors live in a two-dimensional space. I can represent every quantum mechanical state in terms of its coefficient with respect to the two basis vectors, which we normally take to be spin up and spin down, oriented along the z-axis. And what this means is we are going to call those two-dimensional vectors, we're going to call them spinners. They're very special because they arise often in quantum mechanics. And so this state vector psi that can be represented as a linear combination of up along the z-axis and down along the z-axis with coefficients alpha and beta, we would reorganize that in a compact way to call it a spinner alpha and beta. Now, whenever we do this as a spinner, you have to remember that we have to know what basis we're expanding that spinner with respect to. And when we work with things in terms of spinners, then the operators must be matrices, which are going to multiply those spinners. So let's take a look at how that works. The way that we determine the matrices is we simply take the matrix elements of the state vector after it's been acted on by the operator, and then we have to decompose that into a vector that is expressed in terms of the original basis. Now that sounds a little bit confusing, but let's take a careful look at what this means. So what we're writing out for you here is what the matrix is. It's a 2x2 matrix because we're in a two-dimensional space. And you can see we have four matrix elements here. We have the upspin SC upspin, we have the upspin SC downspin, we have the downspin SC upspin, and we have the downspin SC downspin. And all of those vectors are oriented in the Z direction. The way to think of this is I start with a state that is the up state. I act SZ on that state. Now remember, an operator acting on a vector produces a vector. So that operation of SZ onto the state must produce a vector in the state, in the space. And so I can then take that vector and expand it in terms of my basis vector. So I have to ask how much of the upspin is in SZ upspin and how much of the downspin is in SZ upspin. And so you can see if you focus on the columns, that's exactly what we're doing. The first column is telling us what happens after SZ acts on the up state in the Z direction. And the second column is telling us what happens when SZ acts on the downspin in the Z direction. So each matrix element can then be computed from this rule. We have to just figure out what is SC on the upstate. But we know what that is. It's an eigenvector. So it's just h bar over 2 times the upstate. And SC on the downstate is just minus h bar over 2 times the downstate. That means that the matrix is diagonal, and it becomes the following. It's an h bar over 2 for the up up, and it's a minus h bar over 2 for the down down, and the off diagonal elements are 0. How do we see this? Look carefully at that first equation. SZ on the up is equal to h bar over 2 times the up. We now ask the question, how much up is in that vector? Well, h bar over 2 of up is in that vector. How much of down is in that vector? Well, nothing of down is in that vector. So that first column becomes h bar over 2 and 0. We look at the second one. When S the axon, it gives minus h bar over 2 times the down spin state. So how much of the up spin state is in that final state vector? Well, none. There's no combination that has a coefficient that's non-zero multiplying the up state. So that guy is 0. How much of the down state? Minus h bar over 2. So again, the second column vector will be 0 and minus h bar over 2. And it's that simple. That's the way that you do it. And I went through this very carefully and slowly because I find oftentimes students really struggle with figuring out how do I convert an operator into its matrix representation if I've been given a basis. And I'm going to just recap for you how that works. We simply take each basis vector, we operate the operator onto each basis vector. That produces a vector in the vector space, and we just ask, how do I decompose that vector in terms of the basis that I'm working in? And that's it. And from that, you get each column of the matrix. You just do that for each basis vector, and you fill out the matrix. All right, so we did that for SZ. SZ was actually an easy case. Let's look at how it works for SX and SY. We first have to recall the definition of SX and SY in terms of the raising and lowering operators. And so SX is 1 half S plus plus S minus, and SY is 1 over 2i S plus minus S minus. And we have to recall as well, what are the actions of S plus and S minus on our basis vector states? Well, we've worked that out before. S plus acting on up is 0 because I can't raise an up spin any further. S plus acting on down is h bar times up. And similarly, S minus on up is equal to h bar times the down vector, and S minus on down is equal to 0. So now that we have that, we have to just ask, how much of up is in S plus acting on up, and how much of up is in and how much of down is in S plus acting on up, and so on. And then we can generate the matrices. So let me write down what they are for you. They are off-diagonal matrices, and all of the elements are 0 except for one off-diagonal element. And so we find S plus is 0, H bar, 0, 0, reading across the rows, and S minus is 0, 0, H bar, 0. Now from the S plus and S minus matrices, we just plug into the definition for SX and for SY to get those matrices. And so, boom, here we go. We find that SX is 0, h bar over 2, h bar over 2, 0, and SY is 0 minus I h bar over 2, I h bar over 2, and 0. Okay, again, it's that simple. And we're just using the definitions of what the operators do on the states in order to complete these calculations. All right, I do want you to do one more calculation for SZ, for SX, and for SY. I want you to square the matrix for each of those. I'd like you to pause the video and square the matrix. The answer is given for you here. You should get h bar squared over 4 times the identity matrix, but it's really important that you actually go through and do this exercise and really verify that when you square any one of these Cartesian matrices, you will get a number times the identity matrix. So please pause the video now, multiply out the square of each of those matrices, and verify that you get h bar squared over 4 times the identity matrix. Okay, thank you for pausing and going through that calculation. Now, because each of those squared matrices gives exactly the same result, when I add up SX squared plus SY squared plus SZ squared, that gives me the total S squared. And that matrix is just 3/4 h bar squared times the identity matrix. That's a very important result that you should remember. All right, we can also look at the eigenvectors in this new matrix language. Recall that up in the z direction is just represented by up in the z direction. So the alpha is 1 and the beta is 0. So the spinner is 1, 0. And similarly, down is represented just by the down vector. So alpha is 0 and beta is 1. So we get these very nice simple spinners. Are they actually the eigenvectors of these matrices? Well, let's check. Let's find out. When SZ acts on the up state in the matrix language, it's this matrix for SZ, h bar over 2, 0, 0, minus h bar over 2, multiplying the vector 1, 0. So remember how you multiply. You first take the row, the top row in the matrix, and you multiply it by that vector, and you see you're going to get h bar over 2 when you do that. Then you take the second row and you take the dot product or inner product with the vector, and you see that's going to give you 0. So we get h bar over 2 times 1, 0. Now, notice that is a number times the vector that I started from. So this is an eigenvector, eigenvalue relationship. We can do the same thing with the downspin. And you find when you do that matrix multiplication, and I strongly recommend that you do that matrix multiplication, what you find after you do that is you get minus h bar over 2 times 0, 1. So in both cases, we get clear eigenvalue, eigenvector relationships for the eigenvectors of Z. Now, if I didn't know what they were, I could just construct the eigenvectors using our procedure for finding eigenvectors of 2x2 matrices. Okay, so now we're going to check to see whether or not this actually works again, but now for the eigenvectors for X. So you have to recall that when we worked out what the up state was in the X direction, it was the sum 1 over square root of 2 times up Z plus 1 over square root of 2 times down Z. And that means that alpha is 1 over root 2 and beta is 1 over root 2. Similarly, we find when we look at the downspin in the x direction, we find that it's 1 over square root of 2 times the upspin in the z minus 1 over square root of 2 times the downspin in z. So alpha is 1 over square root of 2 and beta is minus 1 over square root of 2. So now when we look at this in the matrix representation, remember Sx is this off-diagonal matrix. When we multiply that out, the first row is going to obviously give me an h bar over 2 times 1 over square root of 2, and the second row is going to give the same thing. When I look at it for the downspin, you see that there's going to be a sign change because the 0 h bar over 2 is going to pick up that lower component of the spinner, and that has a minus sign. So we pull out a minus h bar over 2, and the same thing happens when we look at the second element of that vector. And again, in both cases, these are eigenvalue eigenvector relationships for these two objects. Now let's go further and take a look at how this works for y. We're going to go a little bit faster now. The eigenvectors have an I in the second component. It's either plus I or minus I. And when we look at the matrices, remember the SY also has I's in it. And we have to just go through this matrix multiplication again. I'm going to let you take your time to actually go through that matrix multiplication. And we're going to pause the video, and you should verify that in both cases, you indeed get these eigenvalue, eigenvector relationships. So I'm going to ask you to pause the video, do this matrix multiplication, and verify that these are eigenvectors of these matrices. Okay, thank you very much for doing that. We have one more thing we're going to cover. We're going to look at the anticommutation relation of a spin operator. So far, we've only talked about commutation relations, but spin operators also have something called an anticommutation relation. And an anticommutator is just like a commutator, except it does not have the plus sign. So I take the multiplication of the two operators, AB, and I add BA rather than subtracting it. You might ask yourself, why in the world would I do it? Well, we're going to learn later. You will learn later. We're not going to cover this in great detail in the class, but you will learn later if you study properties of fermions. Anticommutators play a very important role. But it turns out for spin, it's just kind of surprising that someone discovered that the spin operators also satisfy an anticommutation relation. And it's fairly easy to derive, and we're going to do that next. So we start from the commutation relation between an SX and an SY, and we know that that equals IH bar times SZ. And what we're going to do is we're going to multiply on the left by SX for one equation, and we're going to multiply both sides on the right by SX for a second equation. So when I multiply by the SX, you see I'm going to get an SX squared in the first term times SY, and I'm going to get a SX, SY, SX, and in the right-hand side, I'll get a SX, SZ. And so we can summarize that equation as follows here. Now, when I multiply on the left, my first term will be SX, SY, SX, and the second will be SY, SX squared, and on the right-hand side, I'll get a SZ, SX. And I write that second equation as well, and I'm writing them underneath each other for a reason. Let's look carefully at these two equations. If we add them, the right-hand side will become IH bar times the anticommutator. You see these cross terms, SX, SY, and SX, they have opposite signs, so they will cancel. And I'm left with a commutator of SX squared with SY. But recall, SX squared is proportional to the identity matrix. And so the operator is the identity operator in this space. That means it commutes with everything. The identity matrix commutes with everything. If I multiply it on the right, it doesn't change the matrix. Multiply it on the left, it doesn't change the matrix either. And so what we find is IH bar times the anticommutator of SX with SZ is equal to the commutator of SX squared with SZ, but that's equal to zero. And so we've just learned that this anticommutator is equal to zero. And it isn't something that just happens for the SX and SZ. If you work out with all of the three other commutation relations, you can derive the other two anticommutator relationships when the subscripts are different. So you can derive SX, SY, and SY, SZ as well, following exactly the same procedure. So I encourage you to now pause the video and verify that this works for the other two Cartesian coordinates. Okay, thank you for pausing the video and verifying that. Now we have one final result. We're going to put together the commutation relations and the anticommutation relations to come up with a very interesting identity that the spin operators have. So first, we have to just verify that when we take the same index in the anticommutator, we get something that's proportional to the identity matrix. And you've already verified that earlier in this video. And now we're going to summarize the anticommutation relations in a very compact way, showing that it's h bar squared over 2 times this Kronecker delta ij. I hope you remember what the Kronecker delta operator or Kronecker delta function is. What it is it's equal to 1 when I is equal to j, it's equal to 0 otherwise. And so what this says is that when the two indices are the same, I'll get h bar squared over 2 times the identity matrix. And when they're different, I get 0. Now I want you to recall the commutation relation, which we worked out earlier in the class. That said that the commutator of Si with Sj was ih bar sum over k epsilon ijk Sk. Okay? Now here comes the thing that's really cute that we can do because we know both of these. We can look at the product of Si times Sj. Using the add zero trick of adding SJSI and subtracting SJSI, you see that you can rewrite this as 1/2 the commutator of Si with Sj plus 1/2 the anticommutator of Si with Sj. And then when we use what the anticommutator is, that's h bar squared over 4 delta ij, and what the commutator is, which is ih bar epsilon ijk sk summed over k, you see we now have this very interesting identity that says the product of the operators si sj is equal to h bar squared over 4 delta ij plus I over 2 sum over k epsilon ijk sk. That's actually a very useful and important identity. And we're going to find in the class, when we introduce the Pauli spin matrices, that the form of that identity in terms of the Pauli spin matrices ends up being a very powerful object that we can work with and do things with. And that's going to conclude this video. We're going to move on in class to studying the Pauli spin matrices themselves.